buddy David Acton. I thought we'd talk a little bit about medical procedures. I got criticized for having a sloppy first aid kit, so. By the way, let's talk a little philosophy here. This is all about you becoming a better individual. It's not bugging out necessarily, because don't get forced into a box. Don't get forced into being compartmentalized. You know, I see these videos about guys that have 15 different kinds of weapons and say, anyone I see that has a little blood stain on their t-shirt, I'm going to whack them. I'm going to take them out. I'm not into any of that. If you guys want to set up an arsenal and start blasting away and killing people, go ahead. That's not me. I don't want anything to do with that. So if that's prepping or survival, that you're going to whack a bunch of people in the zombie apocalypse, go ahead. What I'm all about is that you need to start taking personal responsibility for your life, because the government's not going to be there. And if you think EMS pre-hospital services are going to be there and hospital services are going to be there, you're sadly mistaken. Why? Hospitals do not understand widespread mass casualty incidents. They'll be the first to tell you. You can take a physician. He may be great in the operating room. You get him out in the field with 25, 50, 100, 2,000 casualties, he's not going to take it. He's not going to know what to do, okay? So that's what I'm about. I'm not about this, I'm going to sit in my basement with my rifle. So anyway, I got this kit. It's more compartmentalized. I hope this makes the guy that was criticizing me a little happier. But, you know, one thing I did add, they're not that expensive, but you can get these EMT kits on eBay, where you can get the stethoscope, 10 flashlights. You can get the whole thing for like 25, 30 bucks. So, but you got to train yourself how to use it. That's what I'm doing. And what's happening is I'm becoming a better person, because I'm becoming a person that can be utilized in a community of having some degree of first aid knowledge. I'm not a person that's going to sit there saying, who can I blast away because I got a video game that teaches me how to kill people. People think that's bugging out. People think that's prepping. That's not. Prepping is you taking responsibility for yourself and breaking out of the system and realizing in a mass casualty incident, the hospital's not going to do you any good. The ambulances aren't going to be there, okay? These guys are all going to take off for the hills. And a bad car accident will overflow an emergency room at a hospital. What do you think is going to happen in a catastrophic disaster? The burns alone are going to overfill, a gymnasium at a high school, just the burn victims. So you think a hospital is going to be able to accommodate that? No friggin' way. So I'm not sugarcoating this today. This is your wake-up call. Make fun of me if you want. It's all a big joke. But you know what? I'm going to take care of myself. You can try to get to the hospital and wait in line with the 5,000 other people that are going to be hoping they're going to get in to see a physician, and they're going to die in the waiting room. Okay? Simple as that. Until next time, this is David Acton.
Hey guys, welcome to the news. I'm sorry I haven't made a video in a long time. I've just been really busy. I'm sure everybody understands the holiday season's come upon us, and we get behind. And every time we try to hurry and try to get something else done, something else gets put off, and I apologize. It's just been really busy. I had a chance to check this news stories the other day, and I just got depressed, you know, and then I checked them yet today and got even more depressed. You know, there's been like 5 or 6 killings of little children just about every day since Christmas. You know, when you read stuff like that, it really makes you not want to do news stories anymore. You know, because I just don't understand how that happens, you know. We're supposed to be a civilized society, and we still kill our own children. So that was a big issue. But, however, we'll get to some stories that I found for today. Okay, and the first student, an ASU student, survived two candy bars melted in snow for 10 days. A senior at Arizona State University who has been missing for 10 days survived on candy and melted snow until she was found on Wednesday. Though she was cold and hungry, the girl, 23 years old, was discovered to be in good condition despite having been stuck in her vehicle for more than a week. She was last seen on December 11th in Phoenix when she left her mother's home and decided to drive north to see the eastern parts of the state. She was in her car, and there were two candy bars and a bowl of water. And though she had a cell phone, her battery is dead. See, if she would have watched Prepping News' stories, she would alert before she went out, because my last video was on making sure your cell phone was charged up. But she was found alive, so, you know, thank God for that. See, once again, you know, that's why we as preppers need to make sure that we're prepared. I mean, we say we are, that we do stupid little things like walk out of our house, forget our cell phone, or don't charge it the night before, and things like that. But always make sure you have your cell phone charged, take extra water, take extra food in your vehicle, wherever you go, because you just never know what may happen, especially with wintertime approaching us.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to Global Government News. Today is Thursday, December 29th, 2011, and I'm Darko. This is my website, ggnonline.com, and ddarko2012 is my YouTube channel. Okay, so before I get going here, just wanted to throw out there that I was thinking of the same thing that David Acton was saying. I was thinking about how a lot of preppers, you just come across some of the videos and how they talk and some of the articles, and it's like, it's almost as if they're a little arrogant. And the thing is most people that should be, you know, at least getting into preparing, is maybe too late, but it's never really too late. I mean, to me, it's more of a mindset. And like David said, it's an individual thing to be empowered like that. And I do come across a lot of people that are like that, where it's all about just, you know, it's about you're going to have a bunch of rounds and you're just going to start killing people and stuff like that. And I don't see it like that. And I just want to put it out there that I don't see it like that. Because basically you're just living in fear then. I mean, you're just surrounded by fear, and whatever's going to happen, you can plan all you want for it, but your plans are going to go to shit. And I'm only going to use that one curse word here because that's the only best way to explain it. You can do whatever your bug out routes and do it over and over again, but until the stuff hits the fan, you're never going to really know. So just getting mentally prepared, and then, of course, physically prepared, you know, working out is what I've been doing, working on my health and stuff like that, health issues, just getting ready for it. And I do that. You know, I live 2 hours away from my parents and relatives, so I live out in the middle of the sticks. So when I do drive somewhere, just to go to the maybe Aldi's or something like that, that's 40 minutes away, you know, I do carry water. I do have a blanket in my car. I put, you know, I bring like a little mini bug out bag that has a survival kit, a water filter, a flint, you know, gloves. I have some polypros, basically really good underwear to keep you warm, thermals. And it is stuff like that. As far as being mentally, that's what I was getting at. Moving on here, Seattle police pepper spray Air Jordan shoppers. So this was, I came across this as a video, but I just wanted to show you this article, because this is what's going to happen when the stuff does hit the fan, or if the economy just degrades to the point where people just have to leave their houses, the water's not running anymore. And so you're going to have this. People are going to be scuffling, and basically they're going to have unrest over what? Over a pair of Nike's new Air Jordan basketball shoes. Scuffles broke out and police were brought to quell unrest that nearly turned into riots across the nation Friday following the release of the new Nike's Air Jordan basketball shoes, a retro model of one of the most popular Air Jordans ever. The mayhem stretched from Washington State to Georgia and was reminiscent of the violence that broke out 20 years ago in the cities as this shoes, sorry, became popular targets for thieves, which is kind of ironic, because I remember seeing the anti-terrorist video when he was talking about prepping, and one of the things that I remember, I'll never forget what he said, was to hold on to your shoes with dear life, because those things will be worth something, and not because they have stupid Michael Jordan on there, but because those are your feet, and you need to take care of your feet. This next one is the rebuilding survivors. The rebuilding of society after a catastrophic event is something that we have not explored at Survival Cash until now. It goes on there, we discussed about the need to establish stockpiles of food, water, fuel, ammunition, along with other items, but it says they never really talk about the reestablishment of society. And this is something that I actually focus on more than just the actual physical, you know, stockpiling everything. I'm thinking mentally. I'm thinking about, how is it going to be in groups? Do I want to be alone? Do I want to be with 2 people, 4 people, 30 people? Where's the limit? You know what I mean? And it says here, I suspect that after an event, a social collapse or societal collapse, there will be 6 months to a year before we can rebuild. I base this on a few theories and ideas. And of course, it's been in movies like The Postman. And I mean, they're these are the elites. They're letting you know. They usually let you know what's going to happen. Says here, we should be able to maintain some semblance of order, a resemblance of order, even if only on a local scale, to our infrastructure should remain relatively intact, barring an outright military invasion war. Three, the gangs of warlords should be routed, and only the people wanting to bring back society will be left, my hopes. Says we will have renegades, outlaws, as we do now, but I have faith in many people to withstand the onslaught of the cowards and gangs and the bullies who plan on preying upon others because they lack the foresight, courage, and competence to prepare them for themselves. Many small towns and communities may be unaffected by the event, other than losing power due to national power grid failure. They will also be spared the burden of most of the gangs initially, but only in the beginning, as the unprepared have to move on and find an area they will have not already plundered. Says here, the time free of this cancer on society will allow for the implementation of defenses and maintaining some semblance, keeps using that word, of civilized society. The people must use the safe zones as foundation blocks to rebuild the nation. And he goes in and talks about, you know, how books and textbooks and literature will be something that will be important to have. Says a council of elders. I thought this was interesting as well. I feel that elders of your group will bring a vast knowledge and experience base to the table. We all have family or close friends that may or may not be able to perform a full duties on the security team, but may offer other skills and experiences to the group. So elders have been looked to since the beginning of time by villages and tribes to make decisions for the entire population, or at least give their insight to the chief to aid in the making decisions. Our current government model follows this idea loosely. Advisors are picked more on connections, favors, or group affiliations instead of knowledge, ability, and intelligence. Elders are not necessarily the oldest person, but anyone who can bring a wealth of knowledge and experience to the table and the ability to share with this group. Now, here's something that you might want to check out. I just came across it recently, RSOE. It's a website, and it shows you all kinds of things. Stuff that I didn't even know that they had available. I mean, it talks about little cyclones, earthquakes, like this up here. There's actually like some kind of oil spill, and you'd be surprised at the stuff that's going on there. But I'm sure when this stuff hits the fan, this may be lighting up all around the area. So I'll post a link and you can go check that out. It's something that you might want to go to keep tabs on what's going on in the world. Home remedies relieve tooth and gum pain. Says for most people, hate going to the dentist. Even for the most minor reason, dental appointments can cause a grown man, woman to quake in fear. So they first have liquid calendula, is a herbal extract from marigolds. It's been used medicinally for centuries to relieve wide range of conditions. You can use it in a mouthwash and to soothe your gums and mouth disorders. Clove oil, it's an old folk remedy for toothaches. It says here, dry socket after tooth extraction. And it has antiseptic properties. You have lysine, vitamin C powder, arnica, also belladonna. It says here, rutagaviolones, and I'm not going to try to even pronounce that word. Link will be posted. Go check it out. Then we have this, asthma part two, the natural remedies. And this is for moderate cases, and I'm not a doctor, and I'm not advising medical advice. So now that I said that, it said you might want to consider the use of natural remedies, ginger and garlic tea. Also, they also have rosemary and nettle. Also, coffee, eucalyptus, honey, using the 9th century to treat asthmatic attacks, turmeric, which is something I take every day. Then also we have licorice and ginger. Also, black pepper, mustard oil rub, ginkgo biloba, leaf extract, vitamin D, which is good for just about anything. Native Americans smoked lobelia. They actually smoked it for asthma. Moving on here, vitamin B17, also known as laetrile or amygdalines, believed to both prevent and cure cancer, along with lowering blood pressure, and to help relieve the pain of cancer and arthritis. It's highly concentrated in apricot seeds, which is what I take, the powder form, znaturalfoods.com. I'll post the link. Now, I know this is going to make your head spin, but B17 contains cyanide, and cancerous cells cause the cyanide to be released, and in turn, the cyanide kills the cancer cells. This is something that's interesting. They said it's very alkaline. Many scientists believe that high acidity in the blood is a primary cause of cancer. And here's the website that I was talking about. They're actually having a good sale right now. Also, Of the Field is a good book as well. They also give you a little card, like a deck of cards with the book, and it's very informative because, you know, to be honest with you, you're only going to be able to pack so much food with it. You're going to have to eat off the land. Hopefully, there won't be nuclear fallout. But either way, the biggest thing is to be mobile, just to be ready to move. This is GGN, and I'm Darko. Thank you.